thank y'all so much for joining us this morning. I know everybody has busy days, and they seem to just keep getting busier and busier. We're going to talk about today in our Tuesday, Kentucky Spins Tuesday Tips, COVID-19 educational update from the last time that we had done an update. Again, there will be some information weaved in there that was prior guidance provided from our last webinar. But I just wanted to kind of make sure, do a couple of housekeeping things first here. My name is Rhonda with Kentucky Spin. I guess I should tell you that. And you will see on that there is the PowerPoint handout. And if you don't have time to download it, not to worry. Or if I know sometimes some people are not seeing on the dashboard the handout. Not to worry, we will follow up with the webinar, with the email later today, so you will have that. Within the PowerPoint, there are links to the guidance that we refer to in this. So just to kind of tell you a little bit about us, and also in if you have any questions, we'll pause periodically throughout the webinar for questions. I'm fortunate I've got Stella with Kentucky Spin on here helping us out, and she's going to be watching for that, and we will take questions throughout it. And also, just so that you know, if we happen to not see it, because managing several things at once, please know that contact us. We will follow up afterwards and help you, because I know sometimes the questions may not show up exactly. So we are here to help you, not just on the webinar, but with anything that you might need. And we'll do our best. Or if we're not the right person, we will connect you with who he is. Just to kind of tell you a little bit about Kentucky Spin, we're the Parent Training and Information Project for Kentucky. And we have been since 1988, since Kentucky first received one. And this is funded through the U.S. Department of Education under IDEA, the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, which is the federal law that calls for IEPs in school for 3 through 21, or first steps, the early intervention, the birth to 3. But I always like to share that with everyone. We also, it's important to know we don't act as attorneys. We are here to help support, build a partnership, and help you as you step through the process. We're here to empower you, and we provide peer support. We are persons with disabilities and or family members of persons with disabilities. And we are here to help you, to guide, not do it for you, but to help you so that you have all the information and resources to be able to help your child best. I am one of 5 kids, and my three of my siblings have disabilities. My twin sister, Robin, had a severe learning disability and as an adult was diagnosed bipolar. She's our special angel in heaven now. And then my brother, Grant, who's in the middle and the only redhead of us 5, is Grant has a physical disability, has cerebral palsy, and also is technically legally blind. And then the youngest set of twins, my mom had 2 sets, and my brother Ryan has ADHD. So we have a combination of the seen to the unseen disability, which brings with it its own unique experiences. But all 3 had IEPs through school and are smarter than I could wish to be. And I am not officially diagnosed, but mom says that we don't need a doctor to tell us that I'm OCD. But and I also am the proud mom to the greatest gift of my life. I foster adopted my son. So that's a little bit about maybe more than you want to know about me. But to all of us here at Spin, we are truly individuals with disabilities and family members helping one another and building those connections and partnerships. One thing too, if you've joined me, you're probably sick of seeing this slide, but I think it's always important, especially when we're talking about COVID and IEPs, or if your child has a 504 plan, to understand that none of the laws changed. But the key to remember here is none of the laws gave us guidance on what you do in a pandemic, right? None of us have ever thought we would live through this. So nothing changed, but you have to adapt it to the situation. So any rights or things provided under those laws are still in place and they did not change. But unfortunately, all of us are having to figure this out as we go because there is not a roadmap that was given to us of what you do if this occurs, because none of us have lived through this before, the majority. So I just want to make sure too, and you're going to see throughout, because I think it's very important. We're going to talk about tips that I will weave throughout this, but I think it's important for you to know and to see exactly where the guidance that I'm talking about comes from, because it's not going to do you any good. Well, Rhonda said this on this webinar. I want you to see exactly what came from the U.S. Department of Education and from the Kentucky Department of Education. As we've all been going through this, there has been guidance that's come out to help guide all of us as we work together for this. So you will see, and I probably can see my cursor that's over it, anywhere, those are the links to the actual full guidance documents. I have pulled out some critical parts that are typically asked questions that we get, and I think that overall is very helpful for everyone to be aware of and to know. But I would encourage you to go into each of those guidance documents to get the full guidance that was provided. Now, here was the important thing too, because when COVID hit back in March, some schools completely shut down, right? So if that occurred where no child was receiving educational opportunities, then the schools did not have to provide the services in the IEP. But if they're providing the education, regardless of where they're providing it, regardless if it's in school or remotely, or it may be called NTI, non-traditional instruction, virtual learning, if that's occurring, then the IEP services and supports have to be provided. And under the 504, for the 504 plan, those accommodations had to be provided too. So as we've kind of been going through this, because we all know that things have, you know, it depends week by week as we're going through this and rates rise of the COVID, the number of people, we've had to go back and forth, right? But keep in mind, if there's no school for all children, because remember, our children are students first. Then there's students who have a disability. So if no student is attending, no matter where the location, then the services don't have to be provided. But if school is taking place, regardless of the location it's taking place, then the IEP services and supports or the 504 plan has to be provided. And that was directly out of the U.S. Department of Education's guidance. And also the Kentucky Department of Education had guidance for that too. Now, I always like to put a side note over here to the side, because everybody always calls things different things that mean the same thing, right? Does anyone find that? Or there's all these lovely acronyms. SEA means your state education agency, which in Kentucky is the Kentucky Department of Education. Anywhere you see LEA, that is your local education agency or authority. So, and that is your local public county or independent public school district that your child attends. So just keep that in mind. You may see those words, it means, but it means it's the same thing when we're talking about Kentucky Department of Education, that is Kentucky State Education Agency. When we're talking about your local school districts, the independent or the county public schools, that's your LEA. So I always just like to go over that. And what it is it, again, they stated here that it has to be provided, those services. Now, back in, because you're going to see that our guidance we picked up, because back in September, we had another COVID update that we had done. So I'm going to concentrate in this as we walk through the rest of this webinar guidance from the September on. There hasn't been as much come out, but there are some very critical ones that I want to make sure that we go over. Now, in this considerations for reopening, and I cannot say enough wonderful things about how important and how grateful I am that even if it's not been guidance that is specific to special education, the Kentucky Department of Education has been very deliberate in not to forget our students so that they are thought about even, you know, special populations. So we have been very fortunate, whereas other states have not done this, but Kentucky is addressing this and helping all of us, regardless if you're a parent, a student, or a school district, as we all navigate this together. So when you're planning on the reopening, again, now I have to say this is that because it depends on where you live and what your district's doing, right? So there is no blanket for the host state. So some schools are maybe still completely virtual, right? So, but others, and especially now that the now in January, the guidance that was provided is that you could, you know, from the governor, that you could go back. But again, always keeping an eye on the matrix and the rate of COVID within your district. So a lot of things play a part in this. But something else I want to make sure that I mention, if your district provides an option to parents, if that you can either attend, stay completely virtually, or you can attend on an alternate. I give you the example in my school district my son goes to, you can either stay completely on the virtual learning if you want, or they're doing an A-B schedule. So they're trying to work the students back in to, you know, at some point when we're all going to be back completely in person, but they're alternating days where 2 days a week they go in person, they're on an A-B schedule. And each district calls it something different. And what is important to keep in mind is no matter what you choose, that does not decide on what's provided with the IEP, because again, remember, it still has to be provided regardless of the location. Now, it may be give it that it's provided in an alternate format, but it still has to be provided. So I want to make sure that I'm very clear about that, is that your choice, if you are able to make the choice, that is not determining if your child gets services or not, because it is to be provided. So looking at this, when we're looking at the reopening, that the ARC, the Admissions and Release Committee meeting, Kentucky, we give it another name. That's an IR, you will see on a lot of the federal stuff, it's called IEP meeting or IEP team. In Kentucky, the Admissions and Release Committee meetings and teams are the IEP teams. So when you go back, and I was very grateful that this spelled it out, is that even when you're going back in person some, we still have to ensure that the IEP is provided, because there had been some things said about, okay, well, do we keep all students in this room? Because people may have had in mind they want to, especially for some students who may have more significant disabilities, but it's not appropriate to keep a child in a certain placement due to COVID. You are to follow what's in the IEP and what's the appropriate placement and the services and supports that they need. And also too, at the bottom here, you will see, and I think it's very important, is that the districts are encouraged not to do sweeping accommodations, meaning that the same accommodations is not going to work for all students. And you cannot you cannot make it to where this is what's provided because the child has a disability or has an IEP or 504 plan. That's the exact opposite of the intent. And a lot of times people are trying to be safe and to take care of everybody, but we have to be very conscious of the fact that with the IEP or 504 plan, those are individualized. And the great thing about them is they're individualized because regardless of what category or what disability you have, I know that what works for my brother is not necessarily going to work for someone else who has cerebral palsy, right? Because our children are different and unique. So we have to still ensure as we are moving back into the reopening and moving back into things is that the tip here is keep in mind that everything is still individualized and provided regardless of the location you're at or where we are at in the process within the district of getting everybody back to so-called normal, which at this point, normal looks very far off. But the great thing is we're all figuring it out together and working through this. There were some other important questions that were answered in this document that I wanted to make sure that I brought up here and some tips because we get a lot of questions about the therapies. First of all, before we dig into this, prior to, because even if you were completely remote learning, right, any therapies, related services, anything that was in the IEP was still to be provided, although it be by alternate means. It might be with the therapist working virtually through, FaceTime or through Zoom. Even small group things could take place by doing it virtually. Some things may not have been able to provide if it required in person for it to actually be done. So again, even if they weren't able to completely provide it, they could have looked at sort of not even necessarily thinking of it's a completely you get it or you don't. So you at least want to get as much as you possibly can, right? And then you're going to look at, and we'll talk about here in a little bit, what might be those gaps of what was able to be provided and what not. Now, as we're looking at the reopening, and again, different districts are at different points along the way. And again, this all could change if things change tomorrow too, with COVID and where our state is and the safety of everyone. But regardless, it still has to be provided. So the in-person, if there needed to be an example, was given the speech or language, and it had to take place physically at school. They can do that. Even if the school's not completely back, those things can take place. But they're saying that you also do have to follow, which you'll see on both of the answers here, the guidance, which a lot of it came from the Department of Public Health and the plans that districts devised for the safety, you know, masks, thoroughly cleaning things. There can also be, because a lot of families have had questions about group therapy, that can be allowed too, as long as you abide by it. Maybe you have the group together and you have the therapist there, that you've got everybody sitting at least 6 feet apart. So it can take place, especially if it requires that in person. So it's good to keep those things in mind. Now, one of the questions, let's pause here just a moment before we dip into this so I see if we have any questions, Stella.
Rhonda, I don't see any questions right at this moment, but just a reminder to everyone, you feel free to type those in the question box and we will get those answered for you.
Thank you so much, Stella. And so when we talk about now, one of the questions, and if you all have been on some of the previous webinars we've done or talking with the school, you may have been hearing the term contingency plan. I'm a firm believer that anytime you can plan, and this is just, I can tell you, this is what's in our life, because our, you know, things are crazy. You can never tell what's going to come up day to day, right? So anytime that you can plan, it's going to be wonderful, especially, and the answer in this, especially when we're looking at, we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, right? We don't know what's going to, because a lot of people think, well, we've been in COVID this long, should we even do that now? I suggest yes, because it never hurts to have a plan in place. And a lot of people, so what is a contingency plan? So, you know, what it is if this happens, this is what we do. Think of it as if you have like an emergency plan for your home, like if something were to catch fire, what is your exit plan? Think of it like this, that if this happens, we've got to have this in place. So it is beneficial to meet, and it gave to where there are the opportunity. Now, a contingency plan, your district may have devised sort of a template or not. This can be done and requested, and I would strongly suggest it be done, because we don't know what tomorrow's going to bring. So we need to lay out what is to occur and how we're going to do it and get it done. To, you know, it's good that everybody's adapting as they go, right? But it is good to have something in place, because I always think that if it's not in writing, it doesn't exist. I need to know my responsibilities in this so that I know if this occurs, this is what I have to do. The same thing goes with the IEP ARC team. It is beneficial to everybody involved if you take the time to develop this contingency plan, and this can be a part of the IEP. So it's only going to help things, and it doesn't mean that you're developing it because there's a problem right now. This is a preventative measure so that you know if this occurs, this is what we all do. So what are going to be some tips that would be good is, again, who, what, when, where, how. So if this happens, we're going to do this. And who's going to do it? Be very detailed, because not only being detailed of who's going to provide it, but the means it will be provided by, right? Because we've all learned, whether it be for our children in school, as a teacher, for our students, in our work life, in our personal life, that everything is going to look different, and it needs to be very individualized for you. And the means that you provide it, because what we're talking about, and many of you all probably already realize, just like we do in our family, as we go to do stuff, you may have the best laid plans, but you try it and it doesn't necessarily work out, you adjust it, right? So this contingency plan all can be a living document too. You adjust it as you go. And all children are different. What might have worked for them back in March is not going to necessarily work right now. We've all been in this for a very long time. And especially when we're looking at the mental health of our students, of our families, of our teachers and schools, things have changed a great deal, and we've all lived through a lot. So we want to make sure that the plan is in place, that it is going to be provided in a means that's going to work for the student and family, whether that be virtual one-on-one FaceTime or virtually in the classroom, what program you're going to use, making sure that everybody who is a part of the ARC team not only understands the plan, but how you do it, because it's not going to do anybody any good that, and also add an example, say you're going to use, and again, I know enough about this to be dangerous, but you're going to use Google Classroom, and you're going to make sure that at this time someone's logged in here to receive this. Well, as a parent, if you do not understand how to, if, well, first, if you don't have access to that, that's an issue too that's got to be addressed. How are we going to ensure that the student has access? Because we have all learned in being very real safe that the internet access is very unstable and many may not even have it. How are they going to get it? Do they understand how to use the program? Are there different things that need to be taken into account? So when you sit down to do the contingency plan, it forces all of us to look at who, what, when, and where very closely, and you probably are going to realize some areas that you have not come up with a plan for or addressed that is a barrier that I didn't know this was a barrier for the teacher, or I didn't know this was a barrier for the student. So having those conversations, that communication is what is going to be critical for our children to be successful. Now, this is one of the things OSEP had released, and I wanted to make sure this was back the end of September. And again, there is more in this, though, that I encourage you to go look. But it, again, reinforced that no matter how the instruction was being provided, the delivery, whether it be in person, part in person, part virtual, or all virtual, that there was still the responsibility of the school to provide the FAPE, the Free Appropriate Public Education, which is under IDEA, Individual Disabilities Education Act, and what is set forth in the IEP. So you still have to provide that. And it's not limited to if you're in this location or not. So, and this was also, I want to pause just a moment just to double check with Stella before we, because this next section we're going to get into is very, very helpful that KDE put out this specifically related for especially for children with disabilities, this Q&A document. So let's check in with Stella just a moment.
I don't see any questions right now, but probably after you get through some of these, this Q&A document, there might be some for sure.
Okay, thank you so much. So in this, and the great thing about these guidances is not that regardless of who you are, if you're a teacher or a parent, is look here, this says this and this, you have to do this. Guidance documents are helping us provide a roadmap, which we needed desperately because it wasn't planned for in the federal laws or the state laws, what you do if this occurs. So making sure, now, again, here it reinforced that the school districts do still have to provide FAPE in the least restricted environment. Again, very specific in the least restricted environment, meaning children should be educated to the greatest extent possible with their similar age non-disabled peers and what's appropriate for them. And that's decided through their IEP. Again, regardless of how instruction is being delivered, you still have to provide that. And it's a top priority that also at the same time you have the health and safety, because many of our students who have disabilities fall in the high risk category when you look at COVID. So being very deliberate in addressing this, that yes, you still need to do it, but we also need to keep everyone safe, and many of our teachers and school staff, they fall in the high-risk category too. So it's a delicate balance, but you still do have to provide it. Now, this is a very important one to me, because this is a question that we get over and over, and making sure that everyone understands too, that in the law, because it does, you know, parents are an equal member of the IEP team and a required part of that. So in their involvement and also the student, it's important to understand just because we are in COVID, it did not change your role as a parent in supporting the IEP to be delivered. Very specifically, it said parents are not responsible for providing FAPE to their children with disabilities or expected to provide the specially designed instruction that typically is provided by a certified teacher or related service provider. It is not our job to be the teacher. So, but we will be helping out with this because given the unique situation of this, living through the pandemic, we do have a unique and significant role as a family in helping with this and to help so that our child continues to learn. But it's very important that we highlight here that just because the pandemic took place, it did not change the responsibilities of the parent under the IEP, especially when it comes to that it is certified or related service. Specifically, you know, there are some things too that's in this and identified is that there can be some different training flows that can help you in your parent role, helping as we are living through this COVID and our new state of learning right now. To help with, and it was critical here, the daily participation. So just like we would help when it's in person and help our child, it's going to look a little different when it's in virtual. But again, you know, you are not expected to be the certified teacher. And what's critical too is because I think the biggest tip overall with any of this, and I know people are probably tired of hearing me say this, is communication, because the communication and the partnership is key to everybody being successful, but most importantly, our children, right? So it is important that you feel comfortable that you can communicate to them what's taking place and what's working and what's not. And I do know too that we're very proud, and we think, I'll tell you, I'm one great example to you, talk about myself, is that I have a hard time asking for help because I think I should be able to handle it all, and none of us can. So we need to be very open to communicating to them. And here's the thing, too. Everybody's different. You need to find that person that is your go-to person at the school that you are comfortable with and making sure that you're communicating with them. And if you happen to go to someone and it's not working out, they're not hearing you, same for a teacher, you work, there is going to be someone that you can access for things to be successful. And the key is finding that person and communicating those needs. Again, this is very easy to say, it's not easy to do, but know that I do understand that as we go through this. There also is a part that, if appropriate, parent training is a related service in the IEP. I do think that I would have never wished for us to live through this pandemic together, but there have been some great opportunities. And even previous to COVID, parent training could be a related service, but now people are more aware of it and you can get that. And that's no two. If you need that to help you in your parent role, not to be the certified teacher or the related service provider, but in your parent role, you need that training. That could be a related service. But no, if you do that, that does not take away from what your child would get. That is an addition to what is in your child's IEP. So I don't want, because I've had families think, well, I'm not going to do that because that'll take from my child. And a lot of times may not speak up that it would help to have training. Because there are, first of all, I have the utmost respect for educators because I don't know how they do it. I would probably make the worst teacher walking. So there are things that we don't know and how to help our child, and there's nothing wrong with that and really accessing those services. But no, if you do, that's not going to take away from your child. Also looking at the assistive technology, what are the needs, like I mentioned a minute ago, for the virtual instruction? Again, the example of, you know, first you've got to have the access to virtually do it. If that's not the case, making sure that the information and materials provided, whether that be in print. I know that districts are doing a wide variety of stuff. Some districts have helped to provide Wi-Fi access. It's going to depend on what's available in your district and what they're providing. But there has to be a means provided for virtual learning, whether it be in paper, in electronically. However, that means has to be provided so that your child can receive the education. And implementation of behavioral strategies that may work at home, because many of our children, regardless of the disability they have, there may be some behavioral needs. And also, too, thinking of, especially now, there may be some behavior needs that are happening now that maybe weren't happening before. But we've all went through a very traumatic thing and are still going through it with the pandemic. But then also looking at strategies we may have used, may have worked at school, but now that this has gone on, they're not. So those are some other things to talk with them about and to get the assistance so that it can help you. I'm going to pause a moment because this is a this has a lot that we went over in this, but this is so very critical to go over this as the parents and the family's role during this. I want to pause to see if there's any questions.
Yes, Rhonda, we actually do have you. My child's assignments are not being modified. The teacher said there is no way to modify the assignments because all of the content is simplified. However, my child has to have help with every step and I have to work. What can I do?
Thank you so much for sharing that question. And that is a very important question. And I'm glad you brought it up, because if it is in the IEP that the child's work be adapted, modified, just as they would have done it when school was in person, that did not change. So it still has to be done. And there has to be a means that that is provided. So what I would suggest, that first, just like what you have indicated, if I'm understanding right, is you've spoke with them and asked them, because it needs to be modified, and that was the response that you got back. I would suggest who typically chairs your meeting, if that is the person, to get them involved. But then also it might be appropriate to have an IEP meeting so that this could be discussed and a plan laid out, because if it is to be adapted and done, regardless of the location it's provided in, that did not change. It has to be done. So it may be the means that they're providing it in, and they may need to do some additional things, because just from, and briefly from the question, you know, which saying stepping through each process, is there something that they're going to put into place that helps? Because your child, and the example is, they're not able to move to the next step. So this is where things are getting held up, and approach it from that way of then how are we going to ensure, and what is going to be provided that is going to help the child get to the next step, because that is part of their IEP and what's in place. I hope that helps. Let's see if there's any other questions with Stella.
Yeah, a couple of more. My child is supposed to have a one-on-one. The aide has never been online with my child while he is doing schoolwork. I'm at a loss and have no idea what to do.
Can you repeat that one more time, Stella? I apologize.
Absolutely. Absolutely. There might be a little delay, too. My child is supposed to have a one-on-one. The aide has never been online with my child while he is doing schoolwork. I'm at a loss and have no idea what to do.
What I would suggest is to request an IEP meeting for it to be discussed, because if the child requires the assistance, it can still, the one-on-one assistance working with it may be for, you know, certain amounts of time that's in the IEP. And again, it depends on what's in your child's individualized IEP. If he requires that, he or she requires that assistance and it's in the IEP, then it's to be provided through all, if y'all are on virtual learning, which I'm assuming you are right now, it's to be provided by alternate means. So that might mean that they are virtually online with them to help them through that. I would strongly suggest an IEP meeting take place so that's discussed, because if it's in the IEP, it's to be provided. That did not change. It's just that the location, given the pandemic, has changed. So I would strongly suggest that, and how... I think it would be very beneficial of writing out a contingency plan so that everybody knows who, what, when, and where is to be provided. And it sounds as if that would need to take place now because you are in it right now. And it would be very beneficial for you all to meet as an ARC team and develop that contingency plan so it's very clear the who, what, when, and where is to be provided during that. I hope that helped. Stella, was there another one you had said?
Yes. My child's school-based therapist said if I do not send her to in-person school, she will lose her spot. Is that allowed?
Okay. So a lot of this, that's a good question, and we are getting those. And we're going to move on here in just a moment, but I want to take some time on that, because if it's in the IEP, it is to be provided. First, I want to know, is the district, and we can help one-on-one with some of this because everything is so individualized. One detail could take you on a different route. So, but overall, if it's in the IEP, it's to be provided. If the district is allowing you to choose completely virtually or a mixture in person or not, your child's special education is not dependent upon a spot available. It is dependent upon they have qualified and have a disability identified under IDEA for the IEP and requires specially designed instruction and related services. So it is not contingent on a spot. A child's IEP is to be followed and provided because they are a child that has been identified with a disability and requires specially designed instruction and related services. So I would strongly encourage, and this is one thing that we can, especially in individual situations, something that we can do is we can provide and work one-on-one with you, and we can kind of help with this. But it is not... regardless, and for some, I do want to make sure that I bring this up too when we're talking about this, because even if your district does not provide an option too, some children with disabilities, due to the severity of their disability, are in a high risk category, and it may put them in extreme danger to go back in person. What's going to be critical is meeting as an IEP team and, again, making those individual decisions based on the individual child. So it's not completely, especially for a child with an IEP, a yes or no. If they don't offer the option, then you have to send them back. Because if it's a child with a significant disability who would qualify and it would put them in danger, there needs to be an ARC team meeting called to develop what is appropriate for the child and for the safety of them. So I hope that helps. Stella, are we good so far?
I think we're good right now.
Okay, let's go through here because I know I want to keep an eye on the time too, because I know we are getting close here. So again, this just reinforces that nothing changed with the law, and this was in the parent Q&A document, that nothing changed due to COVID, right? And that's the same for the state law as well. Now, here's another question that we get, and that all of us have as families, as parents, because should we expect our child to make progress during virtual or distant learning? Yes, that is a reasonable expectation. Now, we also have to look at if they've not been able to and if the district has ensured to the greatest extent possible that they've provided the services, especially designed instruction and related services, that, you know, they are encouraged to make the good faith effort to look at all the alternate means to be able to provide it. But again, if you'll remember earlier when we were talking about a related service, there were some that maybe had to be provided in person that may not be able to be provided. If that's the case, then it states that there needs may need to be a plan for commensatory education services when face-to-face instruction resumes. So what is commensatory education services? Okay, Rhonda's terms, I'm just, is what you should have got in your IEP that you didn't get due to COVID. Now, again, if you'll remember when we were talking about the example of the therapies earlier, is that some may have been able to provide it, not to the complete extent, but that gap area may be commensatory education that needs to be provided. And the ARC team needs to meet to decide if commensatory education is appropriate and how it's going to be provided. Again, it continues here is things that are missed due to the virtual distance learning that's in the child's IEP did not go away when the day changed, right? So whatever was not able to be provided previously still has to be provided at some point, because if it's not, that is considered a denial of FAPE, free appropriate public education. Again, not all children are going to qualify for commensatory education. And it may not be a complete, like I used the example, you did get it or you didn't, right? Because there should have been the good faith effort to where, to the greatest extent possible, it was able to be provided. But for some situations, it may not have been able to be provided face-to-face and, you know, individually due to the safety. So on this, looking at that, there can be, and we're going to talk about ending up here in just a minute about the commensatory education. One question that gets brought up a lot too, and they updated the reopening targeted services guidance document also too, is because some assessments were not able to be provided virtually. And there shouldn't have been a complete not able to be provided. It should have been provided to the greatest extent possible that it could virtually, but there may be some sections where it's not been able to be provided. Those are going to have to take place then once, and can right even right now, even if your district is not back to the in-person, there are opportunities now that you can have those things take place again. Following the guidance and the EOC below there, making sure that everything is cleaned thoroughly. And so there are some things that can take place now, even if everybody's not, or even at an alternating schedule within your district. These individual things, just like what we talked about, some of the one in-person ones, like therapies, could be taking place. So can the assessments for eligibility for an IEP or for a 504. So let's look here then. One of the things too here that's important that we talk about, again, this was in the targeted services, is if the IEP calls for in-person instruction for certain special education and related services, but the threat to the public health is too great, right? Like, we can't have everybody back in person. Then the ARC should plan for delivery of commensatory education services as a remedy for failing to provide FAPE once in-person classes resume. Again, that is the what is in your child's IEP, was supposed to be provided, what wasn't able to be provided. That's going to be that gap area that you look at. Now, here are some important tips to keep in mind. Keep track of what was able to be provided and what wasn't in your child's IEP. And commensatory education can be decided by the ARC IEP team. And this is important because typically, because compensatory education came about through the court systems for denial of FAPE, right? So everybody thinks it's punitive. But the thing here is it was at no one's fault. The pandemic created cases to where there's going to be commensatory education. So we don't want schools, families, anyone to have to go to court to get commensatory education. It is highly recommended that you do that through the ARC team. And this is something that can be decided by each individual ARC team. Request the ARC team meeting to go over, and I suggest looking at closely what your child's IEP says now and have that written down and tracking what was or wasn't able to be provided, requesting an IEP team meeting to discuss the commensatory education. And lastly on here, a huge tip, commensatory education is not to be delivered and take place during the school day. Whenever they are receiving what's in their IEP now. Because if you do that, you're going to cause more compensatory education to occur because you're giving them compensatory education. But at that same fact, if they're doing it during the school day, they are losing more of their specially designed instruction and related services that they would have got during that time during the school day. So you got to make sure that however this is going to be provided, you all come up with a plan because it cannot occur during whatever. Now, everybody's school day is looking a little different and may vary, but it can't occur during the same time because you're defeating the purpose. You're going to cause more compensatory education. So you're not going to be helping anything at all. And there are different ways that compensatory education can be decided. It could be qualitative or quantitative. And we are actually going to be we're going to dive more deeply into it. And a lot of this is new to all of us, regardless if you're a parent, a teacher, a school district, because never before that I'm aware of are we going to have to look on a widespread scale of is that needed for students. And it's not going to be needed for every student. I want to make sure that I'm very clear on that. It is individualized for each individual child and their services. And before we go to questions here at the end, again, together we can accomplish great things by keeping our eye on the most important, which is our child, our student. None of us have all the answers. And this has created a situation to where we've all been doing the best that we can. I can tell you, I look back and I'm like, I could have done that better, you know, as a mom. But you know what? We're doing the best we can. Just like if you're a mom or a teacher or whoever, we have our hands full. But we still have to ensure that our children with disabilities are getting their services and support, because although we are going through a pandemic, they still are to receive their educational rights. And we want our children to learn. And we've got to think creatively, because we've got to think, how are we going to do this and plan? So I just want to let you all know, first of all, you can always go to our webpage. We keep up to date. If you click on the main one, you can go directly through this, the PDF PowerPoint, to our COVID page. We keep all the updated guidance that's issued from the U.S. Department of Education, Kentucky Department of Education, things that may have been important that have come down through different means. We will keep that information updated. We also have a Tuesday tip every Tuesday. Every Thursday, we have additional webinars. Actually, this Thursday, I'll be doing the basic law idea and 504. If you'd like to join us, registration is still open. And if you'd like to join our e-news, our listserv that goes out, we welcome you to do that. So let's take some time here to see if there's any questions, Stella.
Rhonda, there's only one more that I'm seeing, but it's about a 504. My child has a 504 plan, and I don't believe that that is being met. Do the same rules apply?
If you'll remember back in the beginning, through the OSEP, and I don't want to click back to make you all sick real quick, but so it was stated that the 504 has to be provided. So the accommodations within the 504. Now, the compensatory education and all of that, when I was talking about that, was very specific with IEPs. But it still does not alleviate whatever is in your child's 504 plan, just like, because 504, the law didn't change either. Whatever is in your child's 504 plan has to be provided, although it be, again, by alternate means. So we have to ensure that our children who are on a 504 plan, they are still getting their accommodations and modifications, because that still has to take place. So yes, they should be getting that. Now, some other specific things where I was very specific about IEP and all of that, those things would not cover, because that's under the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, for the children to qualify. But all children who qualify for an IEP are also covered by 504 too. But you may want to join us later this week if you're able. If not, we also do record these, and we'll have them back, all of this webinar and the other webinars, on our website before too long once they come back closed captioned. So it may be beneficial, and we also have one that Kentucky Protection and Advocacy on our video library that is available. Whitney Hayes was our guest speaker about 504 plans. You may find that very beneficial. But again, if it's in the 504 plan or the IEP, those laws didn't change. Those accommodations, services, and supports still have to be provided. I hope this helps. Stella, was there anything else before we wrap up today?
I think that was it, Rhonda. Great job.
Thank you so much. Please join us and let us know. You're going to be prompted to complete an evaluation here at the end. Please do so and be honest and let us know, because we use your feedback to do better and keep constantly improving. If there's some topics that would be very beneficial to you, let us know, because we are planning webinars and trainings nonstop. So let us know what is helpful and some things to improve on. But then also remember, you'll get a follow-up email that has the handouts via a link for the PowerPoint. Also, too, if you didn't get a chance when this ends to fill out the evaluation, you will also receive that in that email as well. Thank you so much for joining us today. I hope this is helpful. You all take care now. Bye-bye.